In this tutorial, you put together a small project where you create a new and animated 3ds Max logo, very unofficially of course. The idea is to create a creeping, vine-like deforming object that animates into the number 3 of the Max logo. This exercise makes use of the new and improved Path Deform modifier, which was introduced along with other Spline tools in 3ds Max 2018.2. If you haven't worked the Spline tools before, be sure to watch the appropriate lessons on this channel to get a better understanding of what they can do. To begin with this project, open the scene named logostart.max. It's a simple scene with very few objects that have been organized in layers. There are a couple of lights hidden from view that you won't need to adjust, and a few cameras that have been animated over time with the help of the Move tool. These are simple 3ds Max techniques that you should be familiar with. Currently, a placeholder number 3 is used for framing shots, but you want to ultimately replace it with your own logo. First, try to render the perspective view to get a feel for the scene. The rendering is set to the Art Renderer and is currently somewhat dark. This is mainly because the material in the scene is reflective, but currently has only a black background to reflect. A different background will have a great influence on the render. The best backgrounds for reflections come from spherical panoramas, and a good resource for those is HDR Labs. There you can choose and download a background that you like. For this lesson, I will use Ridgecrest Road. The best backgrounds are made of HDR images, but for this lesson, I'll simply use the JPEG format included in the downloaded archive. When you add this image to the material editor, you can then call up the environment dialog and drag the image as a background map. This automatically sets the image as a spherical environment, and a render at this time would look quite different. You could also set the background to display in the viewport by pressing Alt-B and choosing the Use Environment Background option. If the image appears too fuzzy in the viewport, consider increasing the texture resolution in the viewport configuration dialog. Be aware that this is tightly related to the capabilities of your graphics card. Camera number 3 represents the end of the animation, so use that as a reference to adjust the background. In this case, you can play with the bitmap's U offset value to center the road to the logo by the end of the animation. Of course, and as mentioned earlier, the idea is to replace the current geometry with something animated and more complex, like a growing plant. Start by hiding the current placeholder. To build a more inspired replacement, you need a bit of creativity, even though the most sophisticated object starts with simple geometry. This applies here as well, as we will start with a simple plane object, which we create in the front view. Make it about 50 by 50 in size, with about 40 by 40 divisions. In fact, this level of detail is hardly sufficient for the effect you're after, so go ahead and add a Turbo Smooth modifier to the stack. Set the iterations to 3, keeping in mind that you'll probably need to increase the level of detail even further for the final result. Next, you need to change the shape of this flat plane to display random spikes. You will do so with the help of a Displace modifier. Add a Displace modifier to the stack. It won't have much of an effect just yet. You need a source to define displacement data. You will provide that source using a gradient ramp. In the Material Editor, add a gradient ramp map. Set the type to radial. Note the black color concentration in the center of the circle. This will focus the displacement to the center of the plane object. Adjust the noise values for a more irregular pattern. Set the noise type to fractal and adjust the amount and size values. Apply the newly created map to the displaced modifier as an instance, adjusting the displacement strength now certainly seems to make a difference. Set the strength amount to minus 50, but adjust the luminous center to a value of 1 so that the displacement happens towards the front of the scene. Next, you need to shape the object a little differently, a little organically, so that it doesn't look like a pyramid. Add an FFD box modifier in 2x2x7 control points mode. Adjust these control points so that the object is more streamlined. As I look at it from the top view, it looks a bit like a spinning top. This will work fine. Next is where the magic happens. You need to animate the object to sweep along the spline representing the number 3. Add a Path Deform modifier to the stack. This modifier has been greatly improved in 3ds Max 2018.2. Click the None button in the Modify panel so that you can select the path in the viewport. This relocates the geometry to the spline, and you now can adjust the flow in a variety of ways. Here you want to animate the flow to sweep along the spline between the beginning and the end of the animation. Actually, you want to reach the end of the path slightly before the end of the animation so that we have a second or two to look at the end result. With Auto Key enabled, animate the stretch value to range from 0 to 6.4 between frames 0 and 160. 6.4 represents the end of the path, as seen on the auto label. This is fine, but we need more. We need the object to twist as it flows along the path, and ultimately, we may need some scale adjustments as well. The twist is easy enough to implement, as there is a ready parameter to that effect. Experiment a bit. A value between 700 and 1100 should work fine. Scaling is different. The main problem we have here is at the beginning of the animation, particularly the first 10 frames or so. The sweeping logo should start as a point, increasing in size as it sweeps through. Exit Auto Key mode if it's still enabled. To achieve the scale effect, you can use a function of the Path Deform modifier called Driven Scale. There's also a Driven Rotation function available that you could have used to create a more elaborate twist effect. For our purposes, the twist we introduced earlier is enough, so we'll concentrate on Driven Scale instead. Scrub the animation. By the time you reach frame 60, the scale of the animated object is fine, but it needs to be much smaller prior to that. Enable Driven Scale. In its simplest form, you could adjust and animate the scale value to range from 0 to 1 over time. But you can do much more. You can edit the scaling so that it affects the beginning and the end of the sweep differently. Go to frame 160 and open the Scale Curve dialog by clicking the Open Scale Curve Editor button. The vertical line represents the scaling factor, while the horizontal line represents the length of the path. At this stage, two control points at the beginning and at the end of the path ensure that the scaling is set to 1 as originally planned. Note what happens when you set the first control point to a value of 0. Now the object is much narrower at the beginning and grows bigger in cross-section towards the end. That's not exactly the effect you're looking for. You only want it narrower at the beginning of the path. Use the Add Point option to add a control point to the curve, but switch to Move mode immediately after. If you don't, you'll find yourself adding more points with every click of the mouse. Move the new control point about and see the effect it has on the deformed object. experiment a bit, but ultimately set a scale value of 1 and a path value of 0.2 or 20%. This means that when the object reaches 20% of the path length, its scale is normal or equal to 1. Prior to that, it shifts from 0 scale to 1 between the beginning and 20% of the path traveled. You can smooth the scale curve for softer transition by selecting control points and enabling their Bezier handles with a right click. As you can see, this can be a powerful tool to reshape the object. Continue experimenting and close the curve editor when done. When you're ready to render, you'll probably need another Turbo Smooth at the top of the stack. This will make the object quite heavy, with millions of polygons, but you will need that because of the nature of the object and the deformation it needs. Finally, apply reflective material to the object and do a few test renders of the scene. When you are ready, render the various camera shots to disk, or you can view the sample animation you downloaded for this tutorial. A final version of the scene has also been provided to you.